This meeting is being recorded per Governor Lamont's Executive Order 7B.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome. This is the April 13, 2021 meeting of the Weathersfield Historic District Commission. For those of you who have not been here before, tonight's session is composed of two parts, the public hearing and the public meeting. In the public hearing, we will ask each applicant to come forward and explain their application in detail. This will give us an opportunity to clarify what you're proposing to do and for you to ask us any questions. Commissioners may voice an opinion or suggestion based on their own feelings. A vote is not taken until the public meeting following the public hearing. In the public meeting, which is not open to public comment, we will deliberate your application and decide how to act on it. We may approve it with stipulations, table it for further consideration, or in rare cases, we may deny it. You are welcome to stay for the public meeting, but need not do so. The results of tonight's meeting will be available from the Weathersfield Building Office tomorrow at 860-721-2839, anytime after 9 a.m. Please be advised that the Historic District Commission approval does not preclude the need for other required permits, such as zoning, inlands and wetlands, or building. Please contact the Building Department to review any other permits that may be required before you begin your construction. With this, I'll ask our clerk, Commissioner Lyons, to read the legal notice. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you. Legal notice, Town of Weathersfield Historic District Commission. The Weathersfield Historic District Commission will hold a virtual public hearing on Tuesday, April 13th, 2021 at 7:30 p.m. on the following applications seeking a certificate of appropriateness. Application 6019-21, Liz Bidardi, seeking to install new acrylic signage in front window of business at 229 Main Street. Application 6020-21, Arthur H. Hutchinson Jr., seeking to install 4-foot high wood picket fence in rear yard at 54 Main Street. Application 6021-21, Tracy Riley and Matthew Getzwich, seeking to install 24-foot above ground pool in rear yard with 60-inch deep and 164-inch wide PVC deck, including stairs, handrails, and pickets on deck at 14 River Road. Application 6022-21, David and Susan Whitehouse, seeking to remove shed from rear property, install a 6x72 wood stockade fence in rear yard at 38 Garden Street. Application 6023-21, Eric Hart, seeking to modify original wood windows with Biglass of Connecticut to preserve original sashes, replace glass only at 9 Fernwood Street. Application 6024-21, Rhino Back Roofing, seeking to replace siding with mastic vinyl siding in Newport Bay color at 358 Middletown Ave. Application 6025-21, Margaret Downey, seeking to remove existing garage, construct a new building along north/left property line to be 24.4 inches wide and 34-foot long times 22-foot 3 inches high wood structure with gambrel roof, dormers, and upper deck facing the cove at 400 Hartford Ave. Application 6026-21, Andy Cenzaro, seeking to install 3-foot high wood picket fence and wood lattice around patio area with seating and tables in front of business at 181-189 Main Street. If you wish to review the applications on file, you may request a copy by contacting HDC Comments at weathersfieldct.gov or by calling 860-721-2836. Live participation is available by audio format. Any residents interested in speaking on an application or wishing to listen to the meeting should email HDC Comments at wct.gov or call 860-721-2836 by 6 p.m. on the night of the meeting to be sent a phone number for audio access. Please include your name, phone number, and address in the email. Town of Weathersfield Historic District Commission, Kim Wolf, duly authorized, dated at Weathersfield, Connecticut, this 29th day of March, 2021. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. We're gonna jump right in. We've got a long session tonight. We'll start with application 6006-21, the application for 44 Church Street. Are the Sylvesters here?
I believe they're withdrawing or allowing it to lapse.
Okay, do we have anything in writing from them?
No.
Okay, so.
Not officially.
We had quite a bit of discussion on this at the last meeting. I don't know if anyone else has any other comments to make or if we should simply move to the public meeting on it. This is our last date to act, so we do need to come to some sort of decision. We'll give them a chance to pop up as the meeting progresses, but if they don't, when we get to the public meeting, we'll go ahead and move forward. Moving on then to application 6011-21, the application for our first application for 400 Hartford Avenue. If you'd state your name and address for the record.
Hi, this is Matthew Atwater and Margaret Downey from 400 Hartford Avenue.
Great, welcome back.
Thanks. Thanks for having us back to discuss. I guess we have both our projects on today. You know, starting with the addition, I guess that's for our replacement additions. You know, although they're separate applications, I guess I'm hoping that the HDC gets a chance to look at them together because they do share sort of form and purpose. And I think the purpose is really at the heart of the mission of the HDC. And it's a difficult and complex endeavor, and we've been going through it together for a little while. You know, both projects have a large scope of work, which makes it complex, but they also require balancing the preservation of the historic home, the character of the new community, and the needs and functionality required for modern homeowners. So I guess it's important to keep in mind that nothing we're presenting modifies the structure of the historic home or its ancient additions, but that we are updating and improving, I believe, the additions and outbuildings from the modern owners. And we believe these changes are going to alleviate a lot of the challenges we outlined in our application, improve the character of the modern components, and which we currently think those modern components neither really serve the homeowners nor the historic home in their present state. So hopefully as stewards of the house and together we can find an appropriate solution so we can keep this a beautiful and desirable home for many generations.
All right, well, let's jump right in. Thank you very much. Let's jump right into the details since we have a pretty lengthy application. I'm gonna go right to, I think everybody's had the chance to read the narrative you provided and the opening documentation. I'm gonna go right to what's marked A1, which is the west and south elevations. I'm gonna ask a couple questions as we go through maybe, and I'm sure other people will have questions too. I wanna state up front for the record that I'm gonna abstain from voting on this. We do, we're missing a couple people tonight, but we do have Damian is one of our alternates and he will vote tonight. So looking first at A1, looking at the main body of the house on the new west elevation, all of the main body of the house is going to remain as is that correct?
Correct. Yeah. Yep. This is Mike McDonald, the architect.
And from my perspective, the front door is remaining, including its hardware and the original light fixture on the front?
On the main house, correct.
Okay. And then moving over on that same west elevation, is that, I couldn't find a dimension for the width of that replacement addition. Is that the same? I know that you've raised the elevation, but is the width from the front the same?
So if you look on the A0 plot plan, I've put a large note that says the new addition matches the exact footprint of the existing house, with the exception of a 32 and a quarter inch eastern extension on the east facade. So the west facade that you're looking at, which is called the mudroom, and the main body of this addition matches the exact footprint of the current 1960s or 70s additions.
To be clear on that, there is an extended roof line for that front porch, correct, Mike?
Yep. Yeah, but the footprint where this building meets the ground is a dead match to my field measurements. And there were many reasons for it, but primarily to limit any impact on the original salt box form.
Okay, and then, so you're adding a window and we'll get to the specs on the windows, but all the windows that are being changed or added are all wood windows. There's no clad windows, that's correct?
That's correct. This is the Marvin product, which is a single pane in, true divided light product with an attached storm panel on the exterior. It's fastened to each sash and moves with the sash, but it's a all wood window, true divided light. It's the basic original Marvin window product.
And the front door on the south addition, that's a wood door. I noticed that it has a curved top, which reads a little more modern and certainly more modern than the door that was there. Is that wood door available with a straight panel top?
Yes, there's unlimited variations of the doors. It's a Dutch door, which matches the existing function of the door. And that's the heavy line through the center. The raised panels, it is an all wood door from Simpson, but the configuration of those panels is almost unlimited.
And the roof on the south addition is also going to be wood shingle on the front. Is it wood shingle on the back also?
No, it's not. It's noted as composition shingles on that detail one on A3. We could certainly discuss adjustments there, but we do need to flash that back roof into the main body of the eastern addition. So at this point, the design calls for the wood shingles facing the road only.
And how much taller, because you're raising the grade so it's level, how much taller is that south addition than what was
here? I'm using the floor line as the datum, the main house floor line. That's a general guiding principle of this design. The current addition has two levels, both of them lower than the main floor. All the new work aligns with the main floor of the main house. So the result is you may see roof peaks that are higher. But on my elevations, the existing wing we're discussing is 10 foot, 1.5 inches above that datum line, elevation 100, which is again, the main floor of the main house. The new addition is shown as 12 feet. So there's an approximately 2 foot difference in the ridge height, which reflects the change in finished floor because the ground level there is about 2 feet lower than the main floor of the original house. So essentially that addition is the same massing as the current mudroom or shed addition. It's just raised by the 2 feet of grade change. And, you know, therefore we're stepping up to that door.
Okay, and then turning to the south elevation, I think that this is different than what we saw previously. There's a porch on the front of that now?
Yes, we're extending the roof line of the western roof of that to give yourself a little cover as you come into the door.
But it's not just over the door, it runs the length of the front of that.
That's correct. And there's a single post at the southwest corner.
Okay. And then looking at the balance of that addition, you show asphalt shingles. What is the skin of the building? Is it going to be wood?
Yes, wood clapboards to match the existing coursing, which is approximately 4 inches, but not exact, of course.
And again, all of those windows are wood products.
Correct. And if you've noticed, the 9/6 of most of the windows matches the major windows of the main body of the house at the first floor and transitions to 6/6 at the upper levels. So we've tried to keep the proportions of the new windows sympathetic to the original house, which may or may not be the original window pattern, but it's what we have to deal with today.
And looking at that view on the other side of the house, we see a full first floor story on the north elevation. On this side, it doesn't show anything. It just shows us that first story ground level wall, but doesn't show us any other building underneath that porch and underneath that addition. Can you tell us what's going to be there?
So we're hemmed in on three sides here, one by the existing house to the east, the back of the main house. On the south side, we're retaining the existing deck and building up, removing the old additions, building up to the deck. So currently from the south, you don't see anything below the main floor of the rear addition, and it's because it's obscured by the deck and the grading of the site. Whereas on the north side, there's a full walkout lower level to the house existing, and therefore we had to address a facade to the north. So the grading and the deck obscure any view of the south side of the addition below the first floor.
Okay. And are we seeing the same, what's the material on that porch on the entry level, the front porch?
The three steps, risers and treads and so forth is all wood construction. You do see in elevation one on drawing A3, you see a small stone wall. That's actually part of the patio. Okay. If you look on the plans, you'll see just as you approach that porch, there's a little blue step that drops two risers, and there's a curved stone wall that's kind of a seat wall, and there's a small stem wall that we're retaining. So actually the true south view of that new porch, you're really just going to see the existing loose laid stone wall.
Does anyone have any questions on that first, what's labeled in handwriting A1, but then labeled on the architectural plan as A3? Those details. Turning to the next page, A2 in handwriting, also on the architectural design, looking primarily to start with, I guess, at the east elevation. Does anyone have any questions about anything we're seeing on the east elevation?
I just want to clarify that the foundation and retaining wall stone is going to be reused.
All right, you're asking about the stone?
Yes.
So if you've been to the rear of the existing house on the east side, you look under the deck, which shows in my drawing, there's a bunch of rubble stone, which we don't know the origin of, but it does match the stone in the basement that's below the massive central chimney. So my supposition is that stone was procured when they moved the house over and put it on the concrete foundation. The needle beams are still in place that were used to support the center chimney. And it looks like they mortar set this stone material, say roughly 10 foot square, to bear the old chimney on it. So I don't know if that was extra stone or whether it was the original foundation stone on Jordan Lane, but that stone material is in place on site. The piece under the deck is sort of a retaining wall, but I don't know how well engineered it is. But our intent, as you see, is to use the stone that's around the 60s addition as a veneer on the east and partial north sides. But again, my conclusion is because of the basement chimney structure is the same material. I just think that wherever that got that stone, it's probably from Weathersfield and may have been in Jordan Lane or may have been from this farm area. I don't know.
Thank you.
Jen?
Yes.
I have a question for Mr. McDonald.
Sure. Jump in.
Mr. McDonald, on the east elevation, can you clarify the windows for what appears to be undivided double, well, they're not double hungs. They look like they're, I would assume they're casement windows. Can you specify what you're going with?
So we started in early schemes with double hungs to match the others. The clients wanted to have unimpeded views to the cove and requested that the main floor muntins be removed. So at this point, this would be either casements or picture windows so that the muntins would not be a visual obstruction to the views out.
Okay, and when I was looking through the specs, I saw specifications for what I would assume is the south elevation for that floor and the basement elevation with the muttons. Did you include anything for these casement or picture windows in your specifications?
I did, I think.
Okay.
Sure, and Marvin makes an all wood casement as well.
I think we were looking at actually tilt-ins.
Are we able to see what page number we're referring to in the application?
Let me see if I can find that.
Thanks, Maggie.
Just as a note, the elements you can see in the side-by-side composition, the elements that are currently on the addition are muttonless as well. So we're replacing a set of picture windows, basically, on both sides of that addition.
Sure. And those picture windows that were installed by Eleanor Buchwolf, I believe, were what decade, 1960s?
I'm just guessing. I don't know if we have any documents to really date those. Do we, Matt?
I don't know. I think there's two different editions, obviously. So the Southmore edition, I think, predates the later edition. The later edition being the one that comes out towards the east side. And I kind of just guessing by the look of it was probably the 80s or something like that.
The mudroom itself doesn't really even have windows. They're panes of glass that are hemmed in with barn board. So it almost looks like a jury-rigged fenestration assembly. It does not look like a window product, and the barn board is pretty rustic as well. So that might've just been a porch that was enhanced over time.
Sure.
Returning to those windows, on my application, it's page 17 and the title is Windows East Side. First floor only, and it talks about the Marvin wooden window ultimate tilt turn.
Ah, okay. Thanks, Maggie.
Yep.
Jen, could I be heard?
Yeah, of course.
Thanks.
Yeah, everybody jump in with your questions while we're okay. On any page.
I'll say that generally speaking, my concerns about the home edition replacement have been relatively few, but I would have to say that's because I've really grown attached to the drawings that show divided lights everywhere. And I think that part of that is because when you embrace a gambrel solution and there are divided lights on both this gambrel and the gambrel garage replacement, I think that you're kind of buying into a package. And that package for me would have to include the wooden roof that is shown on the additions that you cited on Broad Street and Main Street. I have to say I'm influenced by our own experience with a gambrel addition, and it is a unifying factor that certainly the form of the addition and in this particular addition separate from the house in so many ways, it'll always read as an addition, but it will make for much less of a hodgepodge. And I think we have, so I would say I'd be looking for divided lights on all the windows and wood roofing on all of the roof. Again, I really came into this with very few concerns about the design of this. And I realized that from the inside, it's a very different feel from the modern undivided light that you currently have. But I can tell you from experience that the view out of a divided light window is something that you can adjust to. And I just think that it's a real collision of styles to have undivided lights in a addition that, especially one that's faced in stone on the foundation and has divided lights at that level. So I realize that you limited the undivided lights to the places where you really wanted them, but I really think the addition works because of all the elements in the drawings with the divided lights. And I'll say that the composite roofing that's described even looks like a lot more like a wood roof would look than than asphalt shingles. And I think that when you take all that together, you have a beautiful project in its full extent there. Thank you.
Doug, let me ask you a quick question. This is Chris. So you have, they're going with those undivided lights in the back facing the cove, but there's one on the main structure of the home that is not being replaced. Maggie, is that accurate? I mean, that's an undivided, that's in the main structure. It's not part of the addition. So if you look at the east elevation, there's currently—
over your back hallway fireplace area has that big picture window existing, which is not being replaced. Is that right?
Right.
That's correct.
That's not part of the change.
That did inform our decision a little bit on where to go with the windows. The fact that really there's only one divided light window as part of the structure right now. So we sort of looked at it and said, well, you know, what are we trying to match, the one,
right,
you know, the picture window or the, you know, or the other? So
I have less concern about that standalone window remaining, Chris, if that's what you're asking.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, right.
Because everything else is going to be so much more visible. And I think that it's a very, I realize it's the view from the cove, but if I were looking for undivided lights, I would have gone with a very different form on the outside. So at least and of course I'm not the designer, but we have a lot of design drawings with divided lights, and I think that the design continuity is really successful on them, and less so on the ones without. Thank you.
And just for clarification, because when we pulled up the page 17, the cut sheet has, so what we're submitting, the cut sheet has the top divided light on that tilt window, but we would be submitting the version of that, they just didn't have a picture of it, that looks like the drawing here. I wouldn't want to have anyone think the top was going to be that way, because that's how the cut sheet drawing was depicted. Right. I would say a couple of things that we were trying to match, sort of that bay window, obviously not obstruct the view, but again, currently there are no divided lights there, and we have added more, like the side of that little offshoot to the east, now on the side that you can see has divided lights and it doesn't currently. And as to the roof, the back of the salt box is the architectural shingle. So I guess I would worry that it might look funny if from behind you have different types of roofing material.
Can I also ask, so the windows that we show now, looking on the east elevation that's on the shared screen, are those smaller than the ones under the half moon? Or maybe to your architect?
I would check the dimensions. They're supposed to be the same.
So all six of these windows are the same size, roughly?
Yes, I'll just confirm it, but I think there's an illusion without muntins that... So the windows are all 30 inches wide. Actually, no, you know what? It looks like they're a little narrower down below.
Not counting those. These would be the non-divided light. So if a mutton had to be, if we're looking for the 9/6 again, they are equal size, is what we're thinking.
Not
counting the ones in the foundation there.
Right. With stone. Well, the plating assembly, the center window under the half round is a little wider, just to,
sure, to balance. Inches wider. Yep.
I mean, it's not a true Palladian proportion. Obviously, the flankers would be much narrower, but
yeah. The five the same size then, the flankers of the center?
I'm saying a true Palladian window, the proportions are not what's represented here. Normally the flankers are about half the width of the center window. In this case, the three windows are close to the same width.
Okay. But proportionally that a 9/6 pattern would not look any worse on one of the windows to the right or left.
Yeah, I think we had 9/6 before the clients discussed improving the sight lines.
Okay.
So yeah, the 9/6 would work in all of these, in the three to the left and the three in the center.
If you go into the hundreds, the drawings with the divided lights are all available.
for viewing.
Yep. The cut sheet, yeah.
The elevations.
Yeah, I noticed we were just looking at an older drawing because the new submission, consistent with the committee's request, the commission's request, I aligned each, well, I reformatted all the elevations. So now the new and existing east, new and existing west are all grouped together instead of having all four elevations on a single page. And I think that's what you were looking for, to compare before and after.
Thank you, we appreciate that. You know, Doug, sort of to your point, that Palladian window on the top, I don't know if any thought was given to maybe a transom instead. I don't know, but moving on, if nobody has any other questions on that, you show a staircase coming down on that east elevation coming towards you, and then on the north elevation, it's absent. Does it, when it comes down, does it pass the front facade of the house there on the north elevation?
If you look on the floor plan, they virtually coincide. The bottom step is aligned with the east facade. That's somewhat subject to final grade, whatever we're chasing the slope a bit there. I'd be open to changing the direction of the last set of stairs and actually running them to the north, depending how the site development goes. But what I've showed on the new north elevation is I put a break line there and I discontinued the railing so you could see the windows in the north facade lower level.
Right. And then again, that door that you can see, same as on the other side. I don't think that this is gonna have a street view at all, but that door again has the curved top, but I don't think that's gonna be visible from any public view where it is. I do have a question though, because when you look at the grading on that side, so when you walk out in the existing house, the man door on the basement on the right, when you look at the elevation, the next elevation, it shows that there's two level of gardens there, two stone walls, two level of gardens. So all of that is going to be cleared out so that you have a full two stories in that, on that whole side. Is that right?
I can't say we've solved all of that. They're two-tiered stone wall terracing. I would want to leave as much as we can, but for the purposes of new construction, I think we're going to end up losing some of it because we have to demolish the old and pour concrete foundation back there.
Well, to get the grade to have the walkout door, you have to remove it, right?
Yes, it's in the way of...
may not have to take it all out, but certainly along the back of the old softbox wall, we would have to clear that out, yes.
And so from my perspective, what looks hulking about the addition especially is when you see on this side that you've got almost a full three stories, but certainly, almost a full three stories from this view. The height of the addition is noted as 16, and I think it says 4.5 inches. And then I neglected, unfortunately, to write on the other side the height of the existing house. What's the height of the existing house?
So I'm again measuring from the datum of first floor level, that it directly below on the same drawing, I've got the old 70s addition and I'm showing 13.5¾ to the peak.
I'm sorry, I'm saying on the main body of the original house, what's the height to the peak on the front portion?
If you go up to the north elevation.
I can't see it.
Yeah, 24 feet 0¾ inches.
Okay, and so then the width of the, and this is a, I don't think I could figure it out on any of the drawings, the width of the original house on the north, if I'm looking at the north elevation, what's the that width of that?
So the addition to the east is 18 foot 10¼ inches wide. That's from north to south. And that's shown on the floor plan A1. Detail 1 on A1 on the floor plan. You'll see
on the I'm looking for the east to west. I'm looking at the north elevation drawing. How wide is the original house and how wide is the addition from that view?
So if you look on the plot plan A0, you'll see the new width you're looking for is 28 feet, and that's 32 1/4 inches more than the current width. And that's what the large note on A0 tells you up in the upper right corner, that the new building addition matches the existing footprint with the exception of the east facade, which is extended 32 1/4 inches further east, plus the decks at west and north. So the, basically, again, the footprint of the new addition matches the existing addition from the 70s with the exception of the east facade being 32 inches further east.
Right, I understand that. And then what's the measurement of the original house?
It's 32 1/4 inches less than 28 feet. So that's 26'4", basically.
I'm not talking about the original addition. I'm talking about the main body of the house.
Well, the main house?
Yeah.
That's 26'11½", which is also on the plot plan and the floor plan. So it's just a little under 27 feet, the main body of the house.
Okay, so the addition's about a foot longer than the original house. And it's
correct.
Essentially three stories tall throughout.
Well, I look at it as 2.5 stories, and that was part of that roof treatment with the dormers and so forth.
Okay.
And that we gave you the cross section this time so you could see there's a clear open volume under the gambrel. It's a single story space with height. With volume to it.
Right. I'm just referencing relative to the original house, the front portion of the original house. It's on par level wise and a full block of building at the same height as what would be the second story in the main house, though.
That's close. The overall house is 8 feet. The new addition is 8 feet shorter than the main house. And it's really the ceiling volume of that addition.
Kim, I have a question for Mr. McDonald.
Yeah, just jump in, everyone, please.
Okay.
That faster.
Or rather, Jen. So, Kim, could you queue up A4? Mr. McDonald, I was a draftsman and site inspector for my father as an architect here in Connecticut. And so my question, there's two questions I have for you. One is just kind of, I think we're just past the A4. I'm looking at a black and white notes. If we can scroll back up.
I believe it's the one page right before that is the A4 drawing versus the handwritten A4.
Yeah.
I apologize for the confusion on that.
It's okay. So while we're waiting, I know what one of the two questions I have.
I think it's one more up, Kim.
Mr. McDonald, given, as you know, and I think Matt and Maggie will be happy to know, I can comprehend their frustration with prior additions to this house as it affects drainage, the salt box and so forth. So when we're looking at this addition, I'm not so much concerned about the aesthetics because following the arguments of Jen and others, this is not something I think that like the door in this rear elevation is going to be seen as a public view per se, but could you be a little more specific about how you're taking care of runoff with snow and ice, freezing conditions as it pertains to respecting the original part of the salt box in the rear of the house, articulating with this new addition? Because I see you have a very creative solution. And then I'll have my second question when you're done.
So the intent is to flash. I didn't want to put a cricket on the old structure. Mm-hmm. So I think this is best illustrated in the photos of the model where the western slope of the mudroom addition actually runs in behind the main house and creates a valley,
mm-hmm.
which would be lined in copper and roofed over and would pitch to the north and south with a small cricket in that valley.
Sure. And I think you make a good point there, which is that models are a three-dimensional analog creation that I helped do professionally. And I think they're important in these kinds of very complex situations where sometimes even a bird's eye view, if you will, with a drawing doesn't convey quite the same three-dimensionality. One last question. So I've forgotten the term, but let's call it the oculus, if you will, the neoclassical element in the Gambrel edition above the triptych with the fan light, if you will. Any thoughts about whether or not that should be divided as a quartet?
Well, I think we had Muntins throughout on this facade until the clients expressed an interest in better view. So I removed most of the Muntins. I don't would not object to variations on the oculus with any Muntin pattern that would be of interest. And sure. I've certainly done them with and without.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's fair. I understand, if I were coming from the homeowner's perspective, but I'm not. So I'm looking sure. at it from public view, and I share in Doug's aforementioned concerns about, yes, we have an existing picture window, if you will, as Jen stipulated, from a hallway that faces a east-facing fireplace, if you will. Luckily, I've been in the house years ago when they kindly put it on the house tour. So it gives me some appreciation. But given that this projects out as an L, if you will, I think I share with my commissioners, I would assume, concern about inside versus outside Muntins versus non-Muntins as it impacts the view. I think I respect that Eleanor Buck Wolf did what she did, whatever decade that window dates from. But I would suspect that that window predates, and that was kind of, now I'll explain what led to my question, what decade that window was put in. Did we have an historic district commission at that time or not? And we don't have an answer to that, but I just remind the commission and the public and the owners that is a concern of mine. Thank you, Mr. McDonald, I'm all set.
Sure.
Moving forward, I think the next couple pages in the application, the really miniature plot plan are sort of easier to deal with when we move forward to some of the more easily read pieces. Going to what is handwritten as A6, which is a piece of a plot plan. Can you tell us what the measurement of the deck is on the north side?
So on the on my plot plan A0, which I derived the accuracy from the original Close Jensen Mills surveys, the deck itself is 8 foot by 15 foot. The main body of that deck, there's a landing outside the exit door from the rear hallway and some steps down, which consumes some of that 8 by 15. So I think the attempt for the clients was to have a shaded area outside, again, with good views to the cove, but also start to relate the interior of the house to the exterior in the direction of the barn. And this would allow possible entry to the upper floors from the barn, since that is an assemblage of two buildings and the space between, which is very important to me in this design, is the space between the two buildings. And the deck starts to help mitigate what would otherwise be an isolated north wall if without the doorway and deck.
Some of the drawings in the application show on the south side the deck with what appears to be an outcropping, like there's going to be a circle or a pergola. Now I can't put my hands on that picture.
So the existing south side, there's a patio of stones and block, and there's a little seat wall of field stone. And I've indicated a dash circle. That's just a pattern in the pavers. So that patio, it looks fairly recent, but I don't know. And then from that patio, as you move east, you step up two steps onto the deck, which I think is definitely a more modern decking material and railings. But we're trying to maintain all of that to the extent the foundation work would allow it.
So I guess looking at A0, which is handwritten A7, I circled, Kim, I don't know if you can bring that up. If I'm looking at the, what says patio and deck to remain, in the upper right corner of that, there's a square off to the upper right side, and then with stairs, that's it right there where the cursor is. What is that?
That's all existing deck construction.
And is that at a lower level? Is that why?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
If you look in the large deck area, there's some steps at the what would be the southeast corner of that main deck. There's some stairs that lead down.
Okay, I got it.
They turn, and then yeah, it's a little bit of creative construction there, but I think it respects the stepping down of the grade.
Okay. And do you have people have questions on this A7? What's labeled in the plan as A0?
Jennifer, it's Kim. I just wanted to let you know that that picture window dates about 1951 in the main body of the house that faces east.
Yeah, that was put in when they moved the house and they put on that little kitchen addition and what's been referred to as the entryway or mudroom that was put in then.
Although I do think off the current addition, there's the big bay windows that don't have any divided light. And I'm presuming that was late enough to have gone through the HDC.
Yeah, oh yeah, definitely. No question. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think, you know, I'm trying to clarify things that we can't easily tell from the plan, so the record's clear. If anybody has any questions going forward, we know, you know, what was proposed. It makes it easier for the approval process if we get all our clarifications up front. And then moving on to what's handwritten A8, diagram A1. Does anyone have any questions on any of those details? And moving forward to handwritten A9, diagram A4, we've already covered those windows. I think that this is just to show us the scale that they've got two full stories with the people depicted. But those lights, the windows there are not what you're proposing. You're proposing what we already discussed.
That was the earlier version of the 9/6.
And then flipping forward to some of the details, the vent roof.
Jen, before you get there, I just wanted to say that at least for my sake, I don't have the problem with the exposed elevation facing the cove being the height that it is, just because the slope of the land really dictates that. And I think that if the roof were any shorter on the gambrel, it might look more like an accessory building out of the basement rather than an addition on the main floor. And so I generally think that I can live with that. And I'm expecting that they'll landscape it eventually as well, so that the stone would be softened on either side of those basement windows by plantings.
Well, I mean, as a point of order, as a matter of fact, if you look at A2, to achieve that east elevation, having a full first story, they'll actually have to dig out to do that. That is not the actual existing grade. So it's not entirely accurate, but it's, you know, neither here nor there. I just think it's important to get straight the size of the building we're talking about. And it does, even though it's using a footprint that's only slightly bigger, volume-wise, it's a lot bigger because it adds a full first story and another almost full third story, maybe so we're 2.5 stories with the gambrel roof. I had discussed previously that I thought a different roof line might help soften that, but the plans are what we have in front of us, so, and you guys are voting on it tonight. So moving forward, to some of the extra details. I think we've all seen the model in a previous meeting. We had sort of an aerial thing that was kind of cool and gave us some pretty good perspective because we got to see it from all sides. Flipping through some of the additional examples we had, and then getting to the lighting issue. So we already covered the fact that you intend to retain the front door light. And then in your proposal, you say lighting will match the current lighting. And then on the following page, you have two proposed hanging lanterns, which are not a match to that flat lantern, single light on the front door. But what you prefer are those two that you proposed?
It was actually the closest we could find to match that. But if we could find a better match, I'd happily come back and amend this if you guys are aware of a better match. It was hard to actually find, like most of the lamps have now the pointy top versus the rounded top. So we were struggling to find an exact match, which is why originally we kind of put in like, if we could save any of the lamps we'd have, we'd use them. And otherwise we were trying to find the best match that we could find.
There, I definitely have seen ones that better mimic. I mean, you're not going to get an exact match. Obviously these are old, right. But what you propose, these two hanging lanterns are not even remotely close to what's on the front of the house. I do know, having shopped recently for new exterior lighting, that there are things that are much closer to that light. But they'll talk about what you've proposed in the meeting, and
yeah, and that's something.
That's a minor detail. You can always come back if you find something that's a better match, and I think there are better matches out there. You can always come back and change it. Moving to the
Ken, I'm sorry, it doesn't identify the color or the is it are they black or they're black, bronze? Yep. They're black. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't see where it says it, but
the coach lights now are not matching. The one on the front door of the main house has six lights essentially, and the side mudroom has four lights of a completely different proportion. They both have the barrel vaulted top on them. The bracket is a little different on the one you're looking at now. So they're not really from the same line of lighting, the current ones. They're close, but they're clearly not the same manufacturer, I don't think, based on the big divergence of lights, the number of lights.
Moving on to the next front door, we already covered that. And does anyone have any concerns about the French doors that they want to talk about? We discussed the door hardware on the front door and the original house will remain. And then you have replacement door hardware proposed. That's a pretty good modern match for it, giving you the deadbolt and the interior that you need. And we talked about your windows and the specialty windows. The roofing material, does anyone have any questions or thoughts about the roofing materials?
Yes, I had taken a photograph when I did my site visit. And now I do see that the original house does have asphalt. I did not remember it that way.
On the back side only.
Yeah. And so I would have to say that might impact on what I said earlier about the roofing material. So that's something that we can address in the public meeting. But I just wanted to say to the homeowner that I'm considering that issue as we speak. Thank you.
And then the decking material. Any questions about the decking material or the layout of the decks? And then the pavers, we've got the specs for the pavers and the gas stoves. We discussed at some length the change in the elevation and the walkway, of course, will have to be modified to accommodate that. We talked about the basement facade, and then the detailing, you've got a page, I don't have a number to refer to it. After the stonework facade, you have a page, additional architectural info. And that spells out that it's all going to be flat stock trim to match, coordinate with the original house, all in wood and wood clapboarding. That's correct?
Correct. That water table may be larger on the new addition than the old. We've got a 1x8 water table board. The old house, I think it varies depending where you're measuring.
The one question I had is, you talk about the porch soffit is wood and you're going to use shiplap pine board. Can you show me where that's going to be used?
That's the mudroom where we have that extended roof line that we were talking about with the post. I don't know if you want to look at a drawing.
I think it's A3.
Yeah, if you look at A3, the south elevation on that little mudroom where we run that roof line out past the western facade to give a little covered porch effect. So I noted for Maggie that you would not see exposed rafters on the underside of that. We'd be cladding that to discourage birds and so forth, bees.
Okay. And then we've got a bunch of cut sheets on doors and windows and how they work. And we don't need to talk about that, I don't think, unless anybody has some questions. And a lot of specs on those. I think we've hit, mechanicals. The placement is shown on the diagrams and what they are. We've got a lot of detail on the mechanicals that don't really fall under our purview. Does anyone else have any questions before we move on to the next application? Or does the applicant have anything else they'd like to add?
I was just going to say that the mechanicals are ideally placed, I think, underneath that deck. If I saw correctly, it's going to be a taller unit than is drawn there, but that's the ideal place for those mini split units is under a deck.
Yeah, and I tried to get them in the shade as well. So you're on the northern facade under the deck. So you should be, you won't be straining the unit.
Well, it'll keep the snow off of it in the winter too.
You got it.
This is a very complete application. With all the information that we need, we really greatly appreciate all the work y'all did in pulling it together. It's a big application and we have the information we need to vote. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Anything else, anybody? Any comments from the public in favor or against? I do have some written submissions that came in to the Historic District Commission through Kim. I've got, I tried to separate them. We had them separated by time of arrival. I've separated them now by whether they address one or the other application that's pending tonight. And so I'm gonna discuss the ones that address the house or both. So the first is dated April 12, 2021, addressed to the Historic District Commission and referencing specifically the house application 6011-21. Dear Historic District Commission members, we write to you in order to express our support for application 6011-21, which is scheduled for a public hearing before your commission on April 13, 2021. We live at 408 Hartford Avenue and are direct neighbors to Maggie Downey and Matt Atwater on the north side. We have seen Maggie and Matt's plans to renovate their home mainly toward the back. The addition, in our opinion, is attractive and matches with the existing structure well. We are not experts on historic buildings, but we do feel that the home additions do not feel, I apologize, do not feel that the home addition detracts visually from the neighborhood. Caitlin plans to attend the hearing and will be available to answer your questions. Sincerely, Caitlin and Mark Wazalewski, 400 Hartford Avenue, Weathersfield, Connecticut, 06109. I apologize if I didn't pronounce your name correctly. We have one that's addressed, that discusses both applications, so I'll read it in this one. I won't reread it in the second one, but it will be part of the record, dated March 28, 2021, to the members of Weathersfield Historic District Committee, As residents of Hartford Avenue, we would like to take this opportunity to support Maggie Downey and Matt Atwater on their proposed renovation plans. We have been homeowners in this lovely community for 24 years. In that time, we have developed a sense of commitment to this neighborhood and this town. We, like all members of the community, have a vested interest in preserving the historic nature of our property while continuing to make improvements that ensure our property is well-maintained, structurally sound, and hopefully visually appealing. Change is natural and often necessary. We have seen the plans for Matt and Maggie's barn and home renovation, and as close neighbors, we believe they would improve curb appeal and not only on their property, but on the surrounding ones as well. We would also be remiss if we did not speak to Maggie and Matt and Maggie's commitment to our neighborhood and the community as a whole. They have owned this property for over 10 years. They have had ample time to understand the dynamics of the of historic Weathersfield and to appreciate what would be appropriate changes to their property. Furthermore, Matt and Maggie have contributed significantly to truly building a community on this little street. Their eye-catching colored igloo in 2015 and their lighted jack-o'-lantern display in 2020 brought such joy to Hartford Avenue and resulted in some great media attention for our town. Being a historic homeowner carries with it a sense of responsibility, trying to balance home improvements in the context of historical relevance. The current barn structure is outdated and does not enhance the house or the property. We are excited for the barn that Matt and Maggie have proposed and enthusiastically endorse their renovation plans. Signed, thank you, Kathy Monroe, Kathy and Chris Monroe. No address listed. So those are the two that discuss the house specifically. Yes.
Chris Monroe has his hand up and Chris, do you want to talk? And you can also address your address since it wasn't listed.
Sure. Good evening, everybody. My name is Chris Monroe and I reside at 351 Hartford Ave. And the letter that was just read was a letter that was drafted by my wife and I. And I just wanted to offer a few additional words of support for Matt and Maggie's design. I think in preparing for, you know, the comments that I was going to make tonight, I went back and I looked at some of the prior agenda notes. And I think one of the committee members said it best, owning an old home is a love-hate relationship. There's a lot of work that goes into it, both emotionally and financially, but it's a commitment that many in this town have made over the years to enhance their property and build upon the fabric of this wonderful community. I think Matt and Maggie fall into that same realm. We've known them for a number of years. We've seen the good work that they've done to their house, and we can't support enough this renovation, whether it be the barn or the house. Hartford Avenue is a wonderful street. This is a wonderful community. This couple not only enhances that, they just add to the fabric of a wonderful community and a wonderful street. So we can't be more excited for this design and hope everybody approves it and further makes Hartford Ave a wonderful place to reside and raise a family. Thank you, folks.
Thank you, Mr. Monroe, and thank you for taking the time to participate. We really appreciate when the public weighs in. It's important to us. Thank you for taking the time tonight.
Very good. Thank you, folks.
Moving on now to application 6019-21, Liz Vidarte or Vidarte, seeking to install the acrylic signage at 229 Main Street. Do we have someone for that?
She was here. I don't know if she dropped off. We could probably address it without her being here. I think it's pretty complete.
Right. Everyone knows where this is going in the nail salon. Kim, is it, it says acrylic plastic. Is it black and white like I see here?
It's black and white plastic. It fits on her, in her existing hanging sign that was already pre-existing.
Okay. If she does pop back up, you can let me know. And if she's got anything to add, we'll go back to it. Otherwise, anyone from the public wishing to speak in favor or against? Hearing none, we'll move on to 6020-21 54 Main Street. If someone's here for 54 Main Street, name and address for the record.
I can probably do this one for her. She was having some connection issues.
Okay, this is the picket fence.
Picket fence, 54 Main Street.
Okay, so we've got a plot plan that shows us where it is. We've got the actual fence as well. So I don't really think that there are any questions on it. If he or she pops back up, you can let us know. Otherwise, are there any members of the public wishing to speak in favor or against? Hearing none, we'll jump to 6021-21, the application at 14 River Road. Did we lose our whole audience during that long application? No, I see Tracy Riley.
Yeah, Tracy and Matthew Getzwich here, 14 River Road.
Great, thank you very much. Sorry about the long one before you. We've got some pretty good detailed plans. I don't know how tall the pool is. I'm sure it's in there somewhere, but it's very small. Can you tell me how tall the pool is?
Just for the record, somebody had mentioned 24 foot round. It's a 21 foot round and it's 52 inches tall.
21 foot, okay. The diagram, which is 9/11, says 24 round. So it's 21 inches round. And I'm sorry, how tall?
52 inches.
Okay. And then you're proposing, we have a plot plan, you show us where it's going. Anyone who drove by, it actually has already been leveled, so there's no grass in the area, and there's little stakes up so you can see exactly where it's going, which we appreciate.
Yeah. I haven't leveled it out yet. I just removed the top layer.
It looks like it's ready to go. So my question is, some of us, including me, don't think that above ground pools are a great fit in a historic district commission. So what we generally do is require it to be shielded from view. And that would be shielded from any public view. You, like I, am on a corner. And so you've got lots of public view from River Road and from Ezekiel Porter. Kim probably mentioned this to you. Do you have a plan on how you're gonna shield it?
In terms of shielding right now, no, we wanted to see what you guys were gonna ask of us. I had a slight thought of possibly shielding it with a lattice, not ugly. I want to make it look nice if I have to shield it. With lattice, and hopefully over the years grow some vines and flowers through that lattice. If that is something that you guys could agree with.
We generally do require it to be 100% shielded from public view, and that can be accomplished with a fence or with evergreen planting that is of the size that already shields it when it's planted. The problem that you're gonna have with the height of it is probably doable with a fence, but then you have a deck that it says the deck rails. So I presume the deck would be level with the pool, but then the deck rails are another 3 feet above that. Yeah, so now you're looking at a pretty substantial, almost 7 feet that you're going to be trying to shield.
Can he with a fence, put, right?
Yeah, yeah. Actually, Jen, can he put that by the garage? Because it is going to be blocked by the garage on the corner.
Do you have some pictures for us? It's not blocked from any view at all.
You would be able to see it? I mean, look at the plot plan.
Yeah. The side along Ezekiel is going to be blocked by the garage. Other than that, you could see it coming down River Road and you could see it going down Ezekiel as and well Howard. From the backside.
And part of the pool would extend past probably the garage. Is based on
probably about a foot would go past the rear of the garage. The front is slightly offset.
So how long can you get that, your deck or the access to the pool, can you get that so it abuts the garage, that wall, that west wall?
Yeah.
You still see it there. Yeah, that's going to be.
Yeah, I would have to completely shroud from the garage around it.
So just to flip through the pictures, the one we're looking at is driving north on Ezekiel, and you can see the grass removed portion to the left of the garage. And then Kim, if you want to flip That's just a little closer while you're driving by. This is from the other side of the garage, still on Ezekiel. It's visible on both sides of the garage. And then if you turn back, this is from the front of the house from River Road. You can see the stakes there still. It really is in the wide open from every viewpoint.
Yeah, there's no trees in the yard.
So, I mean, I think one solution would be to get rid of the decking and just use a ladder, which is what a lot of people have chosen to do in town in this circumstance, because planting something that's going to be 7 feet tall in the amount of area you would have to cover to hide it is really quite enormous. And a fence, you know, you're just not going to have a fence that tall without getting, you'd have to go to P&Z for a fence that tall too. Does anyone else have any thoughts on it?
Yeah, I do. I would say that dark American arborvitae, which is, I think, the variety common name, which is kind of like the soft one versus the spiky one, tends to be fast growing and, you know, can certainly reach 8 feet tall pretty quickly. I think that in that kind of situation, what you might want to do is plant the arborvitae first, not and plan to do the deck after they mature. And so that could be a, you know, a halfway measure that gives you chance for them to grow. You want them to be close enough to create a complete hedge and buffer. It is a very visible area. And typically, especially in the off season, and then sometimes in the on season, they're not much to look at. So we tend to encourage them to be hidden so that everybody can have more affordable cool off. But part of the cost of the structure really is the planting. And in this particular case, you'd have quite a bit of planting to do.
A whole yard's worth.
Yeah. Well, it depends on how tight you make it, but yes, if you were to kind of square it off or round it off to the back of the garage, and have a relatively tight area, of course there would be less. There would be more if you decided to go straight back from the left rear corner of the garage all along Ezekiel Porter, and if you wanted to do the same on the right side. I mean, it would be a lot of planting if you were to try to keep it completely open to the rest of the backyard. And again, I don't think that you'd be able to come to us for the deck approval without some growth on those arborvitae.
I just want to say, I think it's outside of our purview to provide and suggest specific plant material. Arborvitae may or may not be the right choice for that. I do think that they would have to be big to start with. And the applicant may want to check the pricing on those and also the availability, because big things right now are flying off everybody's home. Working from home, I don't want to look at their neighbor's boat any longer. So from experience, they're hard to source right now. But there is plant material, arborvitae and others, that would be great choices.
Thank you. Anything else you'd like to add, Mr. and Mrs. Who do we have? Tracy and Matt. Anything else to add?
No, I think we just need to look into our options to see what will work best and then reapply.
Well, we can table. One of our options is to table it, and you'll have a number of weeks. You can talk to Kim about what your final deadline would be on this application. So you have time. You have time, and it's still early, and the weather's not hot yet, so you've got a little wiggle room.
All right. Thank you. All right. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Can I just add to the homeowner too? When you look at 140 feet depth on your lot that is adjacent to Ezekiel Porter, you don't not have to, I don't think we are asking you to fence that entire area just to kind of shield the pool. And then of course on the River Road side, I know we're not recommending anything, but don't feel that is what we're charging you with either, in my opinion.
Thank you, Chris. That's a good addition. Thank you.
Agreed.
I agree with you, Chris. I wasn't encouraging that.
No, I know that. I just want to ensure it was clear to the, sure. I want to say insured, but the applicant.
Occupational hazard.
Yep.
Too long a day, huh?
Is there anyone from the public wishing to speak in favor or against? Hearing none, we'll move on to application 6022-21, the application at 38 Garden Street.
It's David Whitehouse from 38 Garden Street.
Hi, Mr. Whitehouse. Thank you for your application with the plot plan, which is very helpful, plus a picture of the fence you're proposing, where it's going to go, and the removal of the shed with a picture of the shed. Is there anything else that you think you need to add for us to understand what you're proposing?
No, it should be pretty clear. The shed was rotted when we came in. I think you guys probably remember what the house was like before it was cleaned up. So you want to take that down. And then the stockade fence, you know, I've talked to the neighbors on the back and on the side, and you know, that would just provide some privacy from about the back of their house to the back of the property line.
That's great. Does anyone have any questions for the applicant? Hearing none, thank you very much for coming in. We appreciate it. Anyone from the public wishing to speak in favor or against? Hearing none, we'll move on to application 6023 at 9 Fernwood.
Good evening.
Welcome back, Mr. Hart.
I've missed everybody.
We've missed you.
Even on long nights like this, come on.
Yeah, this brings back old memories.
So tell us about your spyglass.
Oh, we're fascinated.
So am I. And I've been looking at this over the last couple of years online and saw some videos, and I thought they were out of business. And then I saw a sign on Hartford Ave at 263 Hartford Ave, and they did a job there. And I said, that looks fantastic. And what they do is they come to your house, or they do it at the shop, and they take your existing old, sturdy hardwood windows from your house, and they route them out. They then replace where the glass used to be, where the panes were, with a energy efficient glass, so it's sunk into the sash. Then for the muttons, they apply a new mutton on top of that. And I think it's in the specs that I put in the package that explains that process. And it's all primed. And in our case, everything's going to be white. So it's going to be primed white, and then we'll paint everything white as well, just to match the house. And this is going to be all the windows in the original part of the house. And the storms will come off, finally.
I think it's an exciting solution to the ever-changing problem we have with replacement windows. You know, I think many of us feel that there's value in the special old glass, especially in, you know, older glass than the era that your home is even. But I think that this is a really cool solution to retain what are really structurally sound windows, but get all the modern benefits for efficiency and cleaning and whatnot. So, and you pointed to one of my favorite houses to point to in town, an example of a really great renovation using a combination of natural and artificial products, because that house has the CertainTeed on it, and most people would never guess driving by unless you were really looking for it. Does anyone else have any questions about the product or its application in this house? Hearing none, anyone from the public wishing to speak in favor or against? Hearing none, Eric, thanks for bringing it in. We're really excited. You're gonna have a lot of people coming by to watch the project.
Very interested to see it, yeah.
I'll tell you all about it too. And I'll just Just by the way, not that it's a structural thing for me to see, but they take out the sash weights, insulate the where the weights were, and that's a snug fit within the same frame where the in the sill where the sash already resides. So it should be pretty cool when it's done.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing it. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks very much for coming in and bringing it in to us.
Sure, thanks. And forgive me if I don't stay for the rest of the show.
Really?
Wow. We'll see. We'll see how long I can last.
Have a good night. It's going to make you want to come back to us.
I don't know.
Moving on to application 6024-21, the application at 358 Middletown Ave.
Hi, this is Nate McMullen at 358 Middletown Ave. I was hoping Rhino Back would be on the call with me. I'm not sure if anybody's from that company on the call.
It looks like someone's trying to get in right now, maybe. Kim?
I don't have anybody waiting.
I've got a picture of someone that says connecting on my screen.
Okay. Hopefully it's pretty straightforward. I was hoping they would at least present on their on my behalf, but I think I know enough about it to answer any questions, hopefully.
That's what you're hoping. You've got a contractor at least, right?
Right.
So you are replacing, thank you for providing the sample, first of all. We're familiar with the product, and it's something that has not been approved on some projects in the district, but I think it's very close to the product that you have on your house right now. Is that correct?
It is. We actually had some storm damage, and then throughout the years, we uncovered the original cedar shake, and then the asphalt that was covered on top of that, and then on top of that, aluminum. So with this project, we're hoping we can kind of clean up and bring the house back to a little better color and fix a lot of the dents that are in the aluminum siding by eliminating that altogether.
And the color you're sticking to the proposed sample that you gave us, that Newport Bay.
Yeah, it was the closest match we found. There was a darker blue that would actually be a very close match, but I was worried about fading and then having more issues down the road with the side facing Mill Street and Adams Lane. So I thought that a little color lighter would prolong the life of that. And we did just finish the roofing project for the rear as well a few weeks ago, which was great. So that was a good one.
Right now you've got white corner boards. Are you going to retain the white corner boards?
Yeah, I'd be interested to know what you guys' thoughts were. Somebody was talking about, I don't know if it was Kim or if it was somebody else mentioned something to me about changing the reveal or changing the thickness. And right now I think we might be at 3 inches, and I don't know if they were saying about going more or going less. What are your thoughts on it? Because obviously that's something we could change. I'm not married to keeping that white trim. It doesn't, you know.
Anybody? No thoughts? Nate, I mean, I think it's a little narrow.
Nate, it's Kim. When we were talking, I just said to be prepared for the fact that they might ask.
Yes, that's what it was. Okay, I knew there was something. I couldn't remember why or who mentioned that. I knew somebody mentioned something. So maybe I brought up to Rhino Back, I mentioned about a 6-inch. Maybe that's where I got that number in my head from. So I'm certainly open to that. And I'm sure that wouldn't change the scope of work for Rhino Back that much, besides just doing a different material for the choice.
And you're going to retain your,
the PVC porch wrap on the columns.
Yep. And then the, shutters. I'm getting tired, obviously.
Yes, the shutters. We're going to try to take off and see if they'll pop back in. If not, then they're currently vinyl shutters that I think were added back in 2004, 2005 before the house was flipped. So we'll try to retain those. And if not, just source the exact same match I would expect.
Okay. Yeah, if you did anything substantially different, we would want an amendment to the application. The trim around the windows will be the same?
Yes, and what I'm hoping to accomplish is, because we're gonna be removing so much siding, because the cedar, the asphalt and everything else, because we're not doing new windows, my GC was saying we're going to have your windows are going to pop out a bit. So we're going to try to ask them to give me a cost, because this is an insurance claim. For the siding, we're going to ask them to give us a quote on some foam board insulation to add, which will make the windows be, I guess you said they would pop out less, if that makes sense. You guys know what I'm probably talking about.
Okay.
The difference in build out would be matching what we removed.
Does anyone else have any questions for the applicant?
I have one. I would ask them, in the vein of insurance, can their insurance certificate expire? You know that, right?
I didn't look at that, unfortunately. I will ask for a new one, though. I was just happy, you know, it was. don't get me started dealing with this, these guys, or dealing with insurance in general. So,
thank you.
No problem. I'll mention it to him, though.
I have a suggestion as well. When you're talking about widening the corner boards, I think maybe the width of the front of that post would be a good thickness, the post that's on the porch.
Right, those are 6x6 right now.
You know, it looks like it's substantial enough that it wouldn't be too substantial on the corner, if I'm correct, looking at the drawing that was there. If they're 6x6 now, I guess that is pretty wide. But I think that kind of continuing that line up above is what I'm thinking. And I don't know if the other commissioners think that that's 6 inches is too much, and it should be maybe 5 or 4. But I think what's there right now is definitely too small. So I will leave to everyone else, you know, maybe they shouldn't be as wide, the corner post shouldn't, they could be as wide as the posts, or they could be slightly less. So I'll leave that to others to comment on, but definitely something a little bit bigger than what's there now makes sense.
Okay, and you like the idea, and just so we're on the same page, you like the idea of that staying with the white and a contrast versus matching the color of the siding, correct?
I think so, yes. I realize that it's, I just think that it helps to break up a relatively dark color.
Yep, no, I agree, that's fine. I think 6 inches might be too much. Maybe we can find a,
right.
maybe 2 inches more than what the current is, which looks like it's probably 3.
But it may only be 2, but
it could be, and there's probably different sizings in there, because when they flipped over the house, it's a hodgepodge, and one section has some vinyl corner and other section is aluminum corner. So
you know, maybe 4 inches would be enough so that the posts would still stand proud slightly compared to the other trim.
That could be a good middle ground.
Sounds like a nice project.
Yeah, no, I'm looking forward to fixing that and then coming to you next year with some driveway and walkway work. We'll see.
Most of that we don't even regulate, so you'll be
enjoy.
You'll be on your own. Anybody else have any questions? Any members of the public wishing to speak in favor or against? Hearing none, thanks very much for coming in. We're gonna move on to application 6025 back to 400 Hartford Ave. So now we're going to look at the removal of the existing garage and the construction of the new barn or garage building.
And I think now we're back with our architect, Tom.
And again, just for the record, I don't see him. Oh yeah, I do see him. He's muted.
Me.
Name and address for the record again for everybody.
Our name and address?
Yes.
Oh, Maggie Downey and Matt Atwater, 400 Hartford Ave.
And is he one of those people, Maggie? Is he one of the people that?
He is. I'm going to call him and see, because it looks like his name is saying connecting.
Yeah, oddly, he's there twice. One is muted and the other says connecting to audio.
I've asked him to unmute and I don't know what's going on here. Yeah.
in the interest of your time, I guess we can kind of get started with this. And if we have things we want to defer to Tom, we can see if he gets back on.
Yeah, he said he's going to log out and log in because it won't let him unmute.
So I think just to get started, we're primarily concerned to get started with the measurements, because those were the things we didn't have last time. So if you want to go through and tell us how tall it is relative to the house, the existing house, where it's going to be placed on the plot plan relative to the existing house, and then the footprint dimensions, and then the more minor details, we'll get to that after, if you want to start with that.
So if we're talking numbers, I will let Matt do that.
Okay. Tom, did you get on? No, still. Okay. So we've made some, I think, constructive changes, you know, based on the input we've gathered from you guys in the previous meetings. So essentially, I think we've gone to a much smaller height overall. We've made some changes to the actual roof lines. It's brought it down to, I think, 21 foot 9 inches. And our plan is to also, as we have to extend the driveway, to set it back some, which was another suggestion that we had gotten. So we're going to use that opportunity to regrade the driveway such that we can lower it even more relative to the house, which should give us at least a 3 foot, I think 3.5 foot difference between the height of the house relative to the height of the barn, between the lowering the actual scale of the building and lowering the grade. The house, I believe, stands from grade about almost 25 feet. I think it's 24 foot, 10 or 11 inches. And we're going to grade about 11 or 12 inches, I think about a foot, to lower the structure. The width, I think, will be materially the same as the width of the current structure. It's technically, I guess, 24 feet wide. It's we've given 24 and 4 inches, I think, for the cladding. Length
Tom
of it.
Tom said the framing was width 24, but he wanted to account for the fact that we'd have the stone veneer on it. So he added the 4 inches, but the framing is 24 feet wide.
Yeah, which is, I think, all in all, it's a little bit smaller than the existing structure, which I think is like 24 and a half-ish, but it's roughly the same from a front footprint standpoint. And then the length of it, I think we had shortened about 4 feet from the original presentation. So that now stands at 34 feet, I think. Is that what I can't really read what the drawing there says.
It's 34 feet.
Yeah.
So just to back up.
It sounds like Tom might be in.
Yeah, I apologize for that. My system doesn't work too well with Zoom. Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
So, Tom, they were just having us review the size, the measurements, width, height, and length.
Mm-hmm.
So, 24 feet wide, 34 feet long.
And I believe 21 foot 9 inches tall.
Correct.
And you said that you're changing the grade on the front driveway, so you're going to make it, you drive down into the garage. It's not going to be level anymore?
Correct. We did that in order to get a foot lower so that the garage will be a foot lower than the house, in addition to the reduced height that it would be just naturally.
What was the 34 foot high measurement then?
34, not 34 feet high, I don't think. 34 feet long.
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 How far back have we moved back from the sidewalk?
I believe that was 6 or 8 feet.
It's 6 foot. It's 6 foot, about 8 inches, just under 7 feet.
Off of the sidewalk.
The front of the garage is now flush with the front of the house.
Right, it aligns with the front of the home.
All right.
Were you asking how far back from the sidewalk or how much further back from the driveway currently?
No, how much, yeah, how far back from the sidewalk?
Okay, oh. Yeah, because it's an additional 6'8" from where the driveway ends now, from the sidewalk. I know, I don't know that off the top of my head. I don't know if either of you guys do.
That's on the plot plan, I believe.
Let's see if we can.
All right.
Pull that up.
I'm trying to find that plot plan.
Yeah.
No.
So there aren't any elevations that have the barn and the house on the same.
Yes, there are.
Yeah, that one plot, yes. Our page 151 of 212.
Okay. So I show the.
Is that the one?
Page 158.
58.
It's elevation comparison views, number one.
Got it.
The site plan shows the front of the existing garage at 18'6" from the property line, and the garage, the proposed garage is 22'9". I'm sorry, 29'7". Moved rearward about 8 feet.
Yeah. From the sidewalk, that dimension is right, Tom.
Okay, from the sidewalk.
Yeah.
Do we have other elevations to look at? We could slide down.
Why don't we ask if they have anything additional to add? It's a pretty complete application.
Yeah. Right there. You can go back to that. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I think I would add to this is that, you know, the current building's not tremendously functional as a garage, so there are issues we'd like to address with it. We're also sort of, I think, trying to look forward a little bit in terms of, you know, storage space, workspace, things that, you know, hard to add into. So when you think of the two projects together, you know, we don't want to be coming back to you with additional additions. We really don't want, you know, future generations of homeowners to have to come back and make a lot of more of additions. So what we're really trying to attempt here is to think about the future of the home, making it a desirable home, making it a home that, you know, folks can grow into, that you can, you know, see yourself raising a family into. And so we're trying to make the kind of constructive changes that I think would help with that. Recognizing that the barn is significantly different than the structure that's there, I would say that the structure that's there, its only redeeming quality is the fact it's painted dark, dark brown, so it doesn't stick out very much from anything else. But other than that, I don't think there's a lot of, it's not a very good garage, it's not a very attractive structure, it's, you know, proud of the house, it just doesn't have a lot of value.
The prior drawings that you had shown us had from the rear view a third lower level that was walkout height. Is that being eliminated?
That might have been a very early, I think, incarnation of this where we debated additional basement space.
And that's been eliminated.
Yeah,
I don't think we, you know, if we push back much farther, it might make sense to do that because we're going to have a lot of exposed concrete anyway. But our hope is this, you know, kind of coming in between maybe a real setback and, you know, and where it is now to flush with the house kind of doesn't force us too far back into the hillside.
So there's no basement then?
No basement. And I do think, you know, we decided to go flush with the house in part because we really don't want to start to restrict our neighbor's view or block their pool. from sun.
And as much as I appreciate that, for me, it's just the size of the streetscape. And from the front facade to both side facades, when you come off of Jordan Lane, this is a dynamic change of structure to that location. And that's why I'm really kind of hoping we can push it back into the yard a little bit more to make it less impactful on the old structure of the house.
Because I could
side by side, you know, I mean,
this is the application we have.
Yeah.
I could see, the logic behind that. Certainly, we certainly debated that. We even staked that out at one point. So we were really considering that. I think, you know, when I drive by, so I come up Jordan Lane a lot. So when I come up Jordan Lane, I take a right-hand turn. Because the current structure is proud of the house, you actually see a lot less of the house. With this setback about 7 feet, you're actually going to see a lot more of the house coming from that angle where you make that right-hand turn onto Hartford Avenue. In some ways, it'll actually expose the house quite a bit more, even though the structure is much larger. So the setback actually works in favor of being able to see the historic structure from the street rather than against it. Also, you know, in deference to people driving by, I do feel like our neighbors, you know, are going to live with whatever we put there. So I think their needs might, and they have pre-existing developments that they've put in there. So I do want to be differential to that.
Well, this is certainly another very full application with all the information that we requested. We really appreciate you putting all that together. So thank you for that. Thank you.
Go
ahead.
I know you guys definitely have concerns about the massing and how it'll change the streetscape. I mean, obviously, as our submission and something we've taken years to think about and worked with different architects, I do feel like Tom sort of found the right balance of a structure that really meets our needs, but also fits beautifully to me from end to mat, from our perspective, into this sort of historic community that we are a part of. I think we do think it's a beautiful building that kind of fits the house. The house has always had a barn, and that the barns would have been big. And I started, after talking to you guys, doing a lot of research on Connecticut barns and barns in the area. And in many points in history, they were surprisingly close to the house, if not just built off the house in these multiple additions. Also, on a positive note, we left the mullions on the windows off the back of this one. Although I will say, I think from the cove, you're so far away that you won't even be able to tell whether there's mullions on or not.
Yeah, that was actually sort of a driving decision on the other aspect as well, was you're so far away from off property that I'm not sure you could tell what's on the windows or not on the windows in either project. I mean, obviously our design on this was at least inspired by the Cove Warehouse and other gambrel barns in the area. Obviously we have a stylistic, you know, preference towards the gambrel, but we do think it serves to minimize both the roof height while affording interior space, and also minimize the actual front of the building rather than having a traditional gabled roof. So there was some criterion for selecting it in both cases, actually.
Very good. Do you think that there's any details that you need to add that are not contained in the application material that we already have?
I think unless you guys have questions on it, I do think we're really trying to give you as much.
It's a great full application. Thank you. You covered all the details.
Okay. I have, if there are no other questions, I have.
Jen.
Damien's got his hand up.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Damien.
Forgive me if I missed something, but can you clarify, so it's not within our purview, as I want to clarify, as to what you're doing on the inside. That's planning and zoning and building department. But my concern is how it would impact the outside. Because you have a shower and other, water-based rooms, what we could call it, what is your plan for mechanicals? Do you have anything that would be on the outside that we're not understanding as part of the outside elevation mechanically?
I don't think so. I think we included the mini split because we are hoping to kind of, our plan for that space is sort of like a play space and maybe a little extra storage space, a little space to do some work as well. You know, we see it with like a pool table and kind of a you know, just a fun space with a beautiful view. So I think it'll have the mini split so that we can be air conditioned and heated when we're in there. But that's sort of our plan with that space. But I do think one of the reasons we thought about this as well is, you know, we love this home and we have no kids, but the previous homeowners who tried to sell it, it sat on the market for like a year and a half and they had their kids sleeping in the attic. They were sleeping in the basement. And because we want to be delicate to any additions we put on the house, we do think that the house benefits from like the option of a space that's modern that gives people room to move or do something with the space. And so with the addition sort of paired with the project sort of paired together, we're creating an actual master bedroom with it, which this house really doesn't have. And then usable space as well, that you're not restricted by maintaining the home the way we think it should be maintained, which would be not to totally gut the interior, you know, and try to make it more livable for a family. But I worry, I mean, our intent is to stay here for as long as we can. We want to grow old here. We love the house and community, but I worry if certain changes don't happen to it, the future of the house might not come into the hands of someone with a family or who can care for it or wants to care for it because it doesn't meet what they need both in their modern world while maintaining this beautiful historic structure. So that's a little bit of our mindset behind this too.
So let's focus though on the things that we do actually control, which is just the outside details. In the appearance that's appropriate. Does anyone have any other questions or additional information regarding the actual details of the project?
This is Tom. Could I just speak to Damian's question about the mechanicals? There is a, off to the side of the bathroom on the second floor, there is a space that can be accessible from the exterior from the covered patio or covered porch. But that space could also be enclosed and not open to the outside. It is or can be within the insulated envelope and could house water heater and any other appliances that are needed to service the second floor without being visible to the exterior.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you. Okay, hearing nothing further, I do have a number of items submitted by the public. I'll reiterate that there was a positive submission that applied to the barn as well from Kathy and Chris Monroe that was previously read into the record. I also have quite a few additional letters addressed to this one to Kim Wolf. Dear Mrs. Wolf, Ms. Wolf, it is my understanding that plans are being developed to demolish the existing garage at 400 Hartford Avenue and replace it with a new design garage with additional rooms. The existing garage is a structure with a long history in that general location. It has a salt box roofline, the type dating to the early 1800s in Weathersfield, and which is presently the roofline in the home at 400 Hartford Avenue. The garage was moved to its present location in 1952 and was restored in 1997. The new structure would in no way be similar to the existing structure. There would be no attempt to preserve the historic value of the existing garage. My thought is to preserve the existing structure, repairing it as necessary to preserve it. Attached are photocopies from an article, The History of John Deming's The Red House, compiled by Betsy Wolf Innes. This is submitted by Robert N. Smart, 62 Church Street, dated April 8, 2021. And attached to it are two additional pages with excerpts from the referenced history with pictures of the bar of the garage as it was being moved from its previous location in March of 1952. And then I have an additional letter dated Thursday, April 8, addressed to the Historic District Commission regarding application 6025-21, the barn. As southern neighbors to the property mentioned above, we were shown the plans now before the commission by Margaret Downey. We've been neighbors for over 10 years and it has been a very cordial relationship. During that time, the surrounding property has been improved and maintained. As to the overall plans, we have no objections to the plans in total. Specifically, we feel the plan for the southeastern and eastern view that can be viewed from our property would not be objectionable in any way. It appears that the southern side would change very little and those changes would not detract from the building's historic presentation. The plans for the rear or eastern side would provide both additional useful space and a pleasant area that would add to the enjoyment of the cove, the picturesque surroundings and animal life. Thank you for your attention. Respectfully, Mr. and Mrs. Joseph W. Siebert Jr., 374 Hartford Avenue, and they both signed on that. That was addressed to the barn application, but obviously applies to both, so I apologize for that. There's a letter dated April 8, 2021, addressed to Douglas Ovian, Chair, Historic District Commission. Dear Mr. Ovian, thank you for the opportunity to write in support of Maggie Downey's application for a certificate of appropriateness to remove the existing garage and construct a new building at 400 Hartford Avenue. Please share with your colleagues on the commission my enthusiastic support for Ms. Downey's proposal. As a neighbor and property owner, naturally, I have an interest in ensuring that the properties in the area are attractive, well-maintained, and reflective of the historic character of our district. Ms. Downey and her husband are wonderful neighbors who take care in the maintenance of their historically significant home, and as you know, have exerted enormous time and attention to the researching and developing a proposal that befits this important property. Having reviewed Ms. Downey's plans for the proposed building, I am pleased and impressed with the care she and her husband have taken to design a building that is architecturally consistent with the area and of a size and scale that will complement that of their lovely home at this address. Further, it appears that in addition to being more useful in meeting the family's needs, the proposed new building will not significantly alter the view of the Weathersfield Cove held by neighbors or passersby. It is my sincere hope that the commission acts favorably on Ms. Downey's proposal and grants the requested certificates of appropriateness. I welcome any questions or requests for further information that I may provide in support of their application. Sincerely, Douglas R. Shipman. And then finally, I have one dated Sunday, April 4, 2021. Dear Historic District Commission and Mrs. Kim Wolf, my husband and I are writing on behalf of the proposed construction of a new barn at 400 Hartford Avenue. Our neighbors, Margaret Downing and Matthew Atwater, have shared their architectural plans for this project with us. Having lived at our home at 369 Hartford Avenue for over 5 years, and knowing their property as well as the historic significance of their 1666 historic home, we have thoroughly reviewed the proposed plans. While the current structure is charming and older, the new barn will be an enhancement for our neighborhood and will be extremely complementary to the historic residence. We are fully in favor and support this new construction and the utilization of our side yard at our neighbor's home. We are hoping that the Historic District Commission will consider Margaret Downing and Matthew Atwater's building proposal. Thank you for your consideration of this request. Signed, Carrie and Marcus Andizay, 369 Hartford Avenue. And that is it for the submissions from the public. I again thank the public for taking the time to participate. It does matter a lot to us. We're always happy to hear what the neighbors and other towns members have to say. Thank you. Moving on now to application 6026. Yeah.
Chris Monroe has his hand up.
Oh, I'm sorry, Chris.
Hey, it's actually Kathy Monroe this time.
Hi, Kathy.
How are you? I just wanted to kind of reiterate some of the sentiments that were just shared in the letters of support that came through and kind of piggyback on something that Matt had said, which is he takes a right turn onto Jordan Lane every day. I too take a right turn onto Jordan Lane every day. I also walk by Matt and Maggie's home structure. Initially upon seeing the plans for the barn, it is a large barn, agreed. I think that a large barn can be a beautiful historic addition and add value to their property. I think Matt said it will, the changing of the location will showcase the home a little bit better. So I think that while it is a little big, a little intimidating, different than what there is currently in existence, it's only going to be a value add. And it seems clear to me that everybody on the street shares that same sentiment. The other thing I just wanted to point out is in looking at the scale of all these drawings, it's clear they are, Matt and Maggie are committed to improving their property. Almost everybody probably on this call is a historic homeowner, has made renovations to their home. In terms of a financial thing, we're probably, you know, not going to be reaping the benefits of the improvements that we make from our home. We make them because we love them. We want to preserve the historic district in Old Weathersfield. It's vibrant. It's well known for its historic district. And I think the term preservation should be really taken into the context of keeping the historic integrity of things, but keeping things moving from generation to generation to make them livable properties that people are going to want to invest in and buy in the future. That's it.
Thanks very much. We appreciate it. Any other public comments? Hearing none, we're going to move on to 6026-21 Andy Sanzera, 181 to 189 Main Street. Hi, Andy. You have to unmute.
Got it.
There we go.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think this is pretty easy. You gave us a little drawing with where the proposal is going. I presume it's what's up right now that has been allowed during COVID, correct?
Yes, ma'am. The only addition to that would be just to put lattice up on either end and just kind of dress it up and give it a little more privacy as well.
So I like the fence that you've got up a lot right now. Mm-hmm. I think, and is it something that you can move and take down too, so that you can for winter?
Yeah.
I think it's great. How are you going to attach the lattice, and are you really married to that portion of it?
Absolutely not married to it. I'm looking to put some plantings up just to again dress it up a little bit. So I'd be amenable to input as well.
I think it looks great the way it is. I don't think you need to put lattice on the ends.
Yeah.
If you wanted to add some plantings to it, that'd be great.
Yeah.
I think you did a great job.
Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate that. Again, I'm not married to something permanent. I just threw that in there because I actually I do a lot of driving around and try to, you know, garner some ideas, and I did like some of the people with the lattice with the plants that grow off it. But again, that's definitely not anything that's really pertinent to the application.
So Andy, would the lattice be the same height, the 3 feet, or you?
I would if it was something the more after listening to the these comments, I'm kind of it would probably make it an disproportionate shape, because it would, I was planning on, if the lattice was there, it would raise above the fence line on the ends, just as, yeah, as more, you know. So
I think simpler is better. And it's attractive to have a consistent border. And if you were looking to dress it up in some way, your idea of using plantings, I think might be a better choice. I think mixing the materials would impede on the sight line, and part of the attractiveness is seeing the people enjoying your business.
Agreed.
I think although we do regulate landscaping on commercial properties, mm-hmm, what you have putting out planters seasonally, yeah, which would be changing, are not in our purview. You could put something out now, pull them in the fall, put something out at Christmas. That would not be something that we would regulate.
Okay, that's fine. I mean, I do have about 8 planters. They act kind of as supports for the fence right now, just because it wasn't a permanent application. So that's all good stuff.
Yeah, I think it looks good the way it is, honestly.
Thank you.
If it's working.
The only thing that I wanted to add is that I think that it was born as a COVID fence, and that would impact on
the fact that we're embracing an existing fence right now. It isn't necessarily the design that we would embrace in a fence from scratch, pretty close to it, but there might be elements that we might stipulate differently in a different application. But in this one, like I said, I'd rather stick with what you have, and it has a nice impact. The impact on the community is one that we can absorb, especially in exchange for the life that will be behind it. Good luck.
Beautiful. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Anyone from the public wishing to speak in favor or against? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the public hearing and open the public
hearing. Actually, I didn't want to speak, if that's possible. I had my hand up, but.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. Rob O'Connor, I'm 180 Main Street, so I'm going to give you a different perspective on Andy's fence than people walking by who don't see it every day. And it's hard because it's not, I don't want this to sound like it's not my backyard thing. We've lived here 5 years. We love Old Wethersfield. We know what we bought into. We didn't know everything we bought into. I mean, we live with the fire station horn blasting through my bedroom. So now I just make believe it's music. And Andy, I'm a small business owner myself, struggling, you know, through the COVID thing. I realized that fence was a COVID, you know, special exemption that the business doesn't have a permit to serve alcohol outside of a patio. So he'll probably have to look at that. I want to speak against the commission making any action on this application right now. The fence and that permit are good for a year as they are. And the fence is not just like a lamp on a building. That fence, it has actions on the outside of the fence and it has actions on the inside of the fence. And one of the things that we I don't know what the right word is, put up with as occupants directly across the street is the stuff that goes inside the fence when drinking starts. And it's like, it might be the white elephant in the room, but the more people, and I know the plant has 30 people in that fence, that's not 30 people eating meals and just having a drink with their meal, like you might find at the Charles or Lucky Lou's. That's 30 people sitting down and having some French fries to drink. And so I'm a regular babysitter of the business. Again, not to bash the business. I know it's a jewel in the Old Wethersfield mix, but I was looking through the admin regulations and procedures for the HTC, and I kept on coming across, like when you go into the it's like under the hearing procedure, they have under number five, they talk about the structures and the impact on the immediate neighborhood, consider applications for the appearance and the immediate neighborhood. And a lot of things are certificate of appropriateness should not be issued where in the judgment of the commission, the work is inappropriate or detrimental to the appearance of the immediate neighborhood. And I make a case that the fence might be an improvement on the face, but to my property, the things that fence causes is detrimental. It's me having to pick up cigarette butts. It's me having to listen to people swearing. It's me having to pick up beer cans and beer bottles and watch people smoke. And so it's like, it's not all fun over there. I've gone over and I've talked to people there who've told me, you must be really fun at parties. Well, I am fun at parties, but I can go have a nice, I can have a drink with a meal, and I don't need to be police, but there's really no spirit of, hey, telling your people, your patrons at 10 o'clock, there's a noise ordinance. Take it easy on the swearing in the street or banging your car doors or patching out of the garage, the driveway. If this patio situation was in the back of the building, I'd be all for it. It's probably where it belongs. I think it impacts people walking on the street. Walkers on that portion of the sidewalk have much less room to walk with strollers, with their families. It's children having to be right up against the fence with people drinking. And that it's really not, it's not on the spirit of the Village Business District. It's really not. It's as a bar, it'd be fine. A bar with the door shut is what that place is meant to be. And it's the fencing is not what it is meant to be. my opinion. So
thank you, Mr. O'Connor. In a perfect world, the Historic District Commission would wield much more power than we have, but unfortunately, we really only regulate the appearance, and the effect on the neighborhood portion of that is still relative to the appearance. So while I'm sensitive to your concerns, I think that they need to be addressed to P&Z and perhaps to the business owner. I wish that there were something more positive I could offer you, but we don't control those issues.
No, yeah, I mean, I'm just as a side, like the appearance things, like the planters that's being spoken about, they've been out there, but one has had a dead tree in it and the others have been empty. So there's a difference between intent and an application and actually what happens on the ground. And that's the big difference I think that should be projected for.
Pretty sure that nobody grew flowers in December or February or March, but I'm not sure. Could I rebut to that just for you guys' edification on some of these
points? We really can't.
Well, I want to talk to you about the space that between the sidewalks, because it's a fallacy, his point, because if you go down the street anywhere in Old Weathersfield, I have over a foot more of space between my fence and the edge of the sidewalks than say Lucky Lou's does, or Village, or the Bistro, which has absolutely none. There is no walkway. It's too bad, because I do have a neighbor that texts me. I don't know who he is, but he actually texts me and he says, hey, it's 10 o'clock, you know, time to get the patrons in. There's ways to go about having a neighborhood conversation and a neighborhood grouping. I don't, you know, I have cameras. I spent $2,500 on a system because the guy across the street would always say, hey, people are leaving and doing this and doing that. You know, I could say that about anything, but I have proof on my cameras that he's not picking up cigarette butts. And I mean, cigarette butts, we don't allow smoking in the front of the building.
That's Andy. That's right. We're going to get to rebutting. We're going to get to debate with that
for another time, but
we have cameras too. So
I'm going to ask you both to stop. This is not the forum for the two of you to have an argument. I thank you for coming and speaking tonight. We're going to move on now. If I can have a motion to close the public hearing and open the public meeting, please.
I'll make a motion.
May I have a second?
Claire, you're muted.
Second.
Sorry, Claire,
you're quicker.
All in favor?
Aye.
Moving on to our public meeting application 6006-21, the application for 44 Church Street. May I have a motion?
I'll move to deny without prejudice.
I'll second.
Second from Mark. I think that we've discussed this at length in previous meetings. The applicant didn't show tonight. If they choose to reapply down the road with something different, that would be great. All those in favor to deny?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion carries. Application 6011-21. Again, I will be abstaining from the vote.
I move to approve with the following stipulations. Can I have these written down? So if you need them afterwards, I'm sure the commission will change them as we have conversation. The first stipulation is that the front facade of the original house is to remain as existing. Doors, lights, fixtures to be retained. Siding of all the new addition will be wood clapboards to match existing. The south facade door will be two paneled with a straight top. All new windows will be as submitted. And that's my list.
How about the north door, Claire? That was similar in design.
Yeah, but I don't think you're going to even see it. That's why I didn't include it. Thank you.
I'll second the motion.
I think we've spent a lot of time on this application, a lot of conversations with taped but an informal but substantive conversations. It's a very full application. We have a very clear sense of the impact on the district from all the views. Of course, the most substantive view is from the Cove, which is not insubstantial, but is a long view. I personally don't have a problem with the large windows with no muttons on the back. I would want that if I were they. And I think that from the cove, it's not going to be a very noticeable detail. I think that's a place where tie goes to the homeowner.
Any other discussion?
Yes.
Damian?
So I think this was key for me, and I think you could pick up from the questions I was asking the architect and the homeowners. I'll politely disagree with Claire. I think that given the fact that I spend a considerable amount of time in a boat in the cove in the warmer months, that this particular east elevation needs the stipulation that I would want to approve to have the muttons that would divide the window. The fact that the architect during my questioning was open to the idea that there could be a division, at least simulated, indicates, I think, a willingness to divide these windows. And I think that it will be something that sets a proper precedent for any windows for the future, given the fact that, as you picked up from my questioning early on this evening, the dating of the picture windows predates the creation of the Historic District Commission. So what we're looking to do here is set a precedent for the kinds of windows that all of us would see, not just months and years, but even decades from now facing the cove. So that I will politely disagree.
As a procedural matter, Mark, did you second the motion?
I did. Jen.
Thank you, Chris. I just didn't have it noted. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would, no surprise, have to agree with Damian. Everything about this addition is inspired by the period. It is not an attempt to create a modernized version of the Cove Warehouse, especially if there are divided light windows on the basement level right below it. I think it's incongruous to have the windows undivided. And I have to say that, as I said earlier, I was won over by the drawings, multiple drawings in today's submission where the lights are divided. I would say at least as many drawings with them divided overall as not. So it wasn't until earlier today that I caught the homeowner's new preference. As far as the roof shingles go, you know, I certainly feel differently about that than what I said originally. And so the as submitted is not a problem for me there, but I could not support the look from the back being with divided lights in some places and undivided lights in others. Depending on where you're paddling, you know, your view is going to be either something that looks like the back of Buzz Willard's house or the first house on Broad Street or something that is a mix of very colonial form with a modern window. I'm not saying you can't make a modern gambrel, but one of the main reasons for this gambrel is part of a story that I thought was being attempted on both the back of the house and the garage replacement. So I would disagree with the current motion.
I think I probably would lean towards what Commissioner Mead had said. I think that you know, I think the detail that they've put into the house and the thought, I really like what they've done. And I think it's, as far as the back view, again, I have to say, Damian, I don't do a lot of paddling in the back, or I'm not in a boat in the cove. I do go to the cove and watch some sunsets. So I do get that view every now and then, but I don't know. Maybe when you're ice fishing, you could, you know, you can get a closer view to see the two different windows. But I think the impact there is minimal in my opinion.
Yeah, I'd agree, and I second Claire's motion only because I could go either way on the divided lights. Although they went to great pains to identify it as the period, it's still, you're going to tell it's a 2021 addition to the home. There's a railing in front from the deck. It's a high elevation, and I, that's why I supported. I have no problem with the no divided lights, especially since the ones on the original structure. Everything else though was complete application. We've talked about this, it seems like, since January.
It has been. It has been.
The pre-hearings are submitted or not. So I applaud them to hanging in there, and it's a great addition, and it.
Look forward to seeing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we want them to be able to break ground this spring.
All countries have now been heard from. I'm going to call the vote. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed?
Nay.
Three in favor and two opposed. The motion carries. The application is approved with the submitted stipulations. Again, I abstained from the vote. Application number 6019-21229 Main Street. May I have a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve as submitted with the application.
May I have a second?
I'll second it for discussion.
I did see the window, the acrylic. I guess I probably should ask Kim. This is not lettering on the window, right? It is a...
Correct.
I mean, the window's sitting on, or the sign seems to be sitting on the sill right now.
It's just sitting there for now. Yeah. It will go in the space that was previously had the Annie's Nails sign.
So those were hung by chains. It's a freestanding floating sign, I believe, right?
It was attached, so it would actually need to be removed, but it's an existing piece of, it's an existing structure.
Then maybe to get this clarified, am I accurate in saying that the sign is there? It seems to match their dimensions. That's sitting right now on kind of the, lack of a better word, the window seat or the sill. It's as simple as can be. It's black.
That's correct. Yes.
Yeah. So if that's the sign, then I would continue with my motion. If not, we can table it if the other one has concerns about how it's going to be hung.
That is the sign.
Okay.
Oh, I think we're all set.
Yeah.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, the motion carries. Application 602054 Main Street. May I have a motion?
Motion to approve is submitted.
I'll second. All the detail was there that we need. It's a very nice fence in a nice spot, certainly appropriate for the district and for this piece of property. Anybody else? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, the application is approved. Application for 6021-21, the application at 14 River Road. May I have a motion?
Make a motion to table. Oh, go ahead, Claire.
Yeah, you go ahead.
Make a motion to table the application.
I'll second.
The applicant has some ideas on screening and they'll present us next meeting.
Yeah, I think it would be useful to have a plot plan and more specific details. And I think that Doug's recommendation to maybe postpone the deck with the railings.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Something grows and can hide it, because that's going to take us, you know, trying to buy a greenery of that height is quite the undertaking. So I think that was a great idea. All those in favor of tabling say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, the motion carries. Application 602321, the application for 9 Fernwood Road. Oh, I'm sorry, I skipped one. Application 6022, 38 Garden Street. This is the removal of the shed and the stockade. May I have a motion?
Move to approve as submitted.
Second.
It's a standard switch out. And I think that we have lots of predicate for this activity in the district.
Oh, I think the removal of the shed is an improvement for sure. And the stockade fence will have a minimal impact and is appropriate for the property. All those in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, the motion carries. Application 60239 Fernwood Street.
Motion to approve is submitted.
Second.
Everywhere. I think it's a great project.
Fascinating.
We've only seen it once before, and I missed it actually going in. So I look forward to actually being able to see how they do it. But it certainly is going to retain those great windows on this particular property, but still achieve what the homeowner wants. Perfectly appropriate. May I, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, the motion carries. The application is approved. The application for 358 Middletown Avenue, may I have a motion? I'll make a motion to approve with the stipulation that the corner boards be increased in width to 4 inches.
Second.
I think that this is an appropriate remodel on this house that already has siding on it. We're replacing something that's going to be virtually indistinguishable from what's there once it's properly applied. I think that the maybe one drawback on the house as it stands right now is that it has very narrow corner boards, and I think something more substantial is going to be an improvement on the property. I think it's an appropriate change, and it will have a minimal impact on the district. Anyone else? All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, the motion carries. Application 6025. Back to 400 Hartford Avenue. Again, I'll be abstaining. May I have a motion?
I move to deny for the purposes of conversation.
May I have a second?
I'll second for conversation's sake.
I think my concern here, I would like to respect the homeowners and architects and engineers' efforts to try to respect our concerns about the exterior appearance and massing of the garage, which at this point we could consider a 2.5 to 3 story mixed use outbuilding, but that I sense not only my concerns, but my colleagues' concerns, the massing is still something that we need to work on along with the setback. It's a work in progress.
I think in that case then, Damien, you're not asking for a flat out denial as much as a denial without prejudice.
Then I
but
will.
But couldn't a denial, they can bring back an application that's not the same application. They could come back with a structure that had was different size, was a different location, right?
Correct.
They just can't bring back the same application.
Right. I mean, without prejudice doesn't charge them another $25 for their trouble.
Then I
don't
will
think that's a concern.
All right.
But okay.
I will technically modify my motion that we deny without prejudice, given the stipulations that you've just made, Commissioner Doug. I think what we're trying to specify here, though, is that these have been it's been an ongoing conversation between ourselves, the homeowners, and the architect, and others. And we're heading in the right direction, but we're not quite there yet.
Well, I guess I would ask you, Damien, would you be more satisfied with the building as is if it were just one full car length deep rather than a tandem?
So I'm going to just interject for 1 second. Sorry, Damien, to interrupt, but we need to stick with the application at hand and not in this conversation
Yes.
Begin to get into what we may or may not think extra. I think we need to stick to this application at hand.
All right, then I can do that.
I think in fairness to us and to the applicants, we can't go into hypothetical land.
I agree, Claire. And so for that reason, I won't directly answer Doug's question other than to be deliberately vague and say, you know, like I said a minute ago, we're heading in the right direction. We're not there yet.
I appreciate that, Damien. I understand, Claire, what you're saying. I do think then what we have to do is address on the merits the argument that was made, at least in part, by some of the public comments that, and by the homeowner, that it's not inappropriate to consider a barn that's larger than the house, which this is not overall, but certainly as you're driving south on Hartford Avenue and seeing it without the turn from Jordan Lane, you're seeing a tandem length building. And I guess the question is can the physical land, at least in part, handle the additional massing? And I think that there's an argument to be made that it can. It's a huge lot.
Mm-hmm.
There are many predicates for sizable barns, which when needing to be accessible to a road can be relatively close to the road. And I think that's the question is, can it coexist with what's on the property? And when you come from the south, those additions that are somewhat visible, you know, still don't take away the fact that you get a full-on view of the building from one angle. Whether that type of view is required from both, in order to maintain the integrity of the and primacy of that structure, I think is an open question. I think that what you get in terms of the view from Wethersfield as you're going towards Hartford, and I suppose to a certain extent what you're gaining from the setback, although certainly by adding a story to the roof, even if it's softened by gambrel, you're going to lose some of the view as well. But I think that saying that the building is too big without acknowledging the size of the property, I think that we need to be more distinct. I think that what you're, I assume that what you're saying, Damien, is that you don't want a barn that appears as substantial as that near the house.
For me, I think, go ahead, Mark.
I think the point is the size definitely houses or can house the size of a barn that big. I just don't think, in my opinion, and again, there's a lot of barns set back in Hartford Ave. You see them all over the place, but they're set back. Okay. And what we're talking about is putting it, it's actually, you know, right in between two houses, one which is very sort of, for lack of a better term, petite and very modest in the way it expresses itself. And the other one is a much bigger farmhouse to the left of it. You know, so a barn in that property could work. It's my opinion that it's just too big for that spot in the middle of that space.
I agree, Mark.
Back or put into a different location on the lot. If they want something of that size, if they want something smaller, we could take a look at, you know, maybe it not having to be pushed back so much.
When you think of Main Street in Wethersfield and how close the houses are at Main and State,
mm-hmm.
And you think about the fact that at Jordan and Hartford Avenue, the distance between 400 and the house to the north of it, and the fact that this would be replacing an existing building, I just don't know that it is as reasonable to say that this particular barn has to be down below when there's always been a structure at street level.
You know, right there. I think, sorry, Doug, I think, sure. Are you finished? Thank you. You know, we've had three conversations in great depth about this barn. And in every conversation, we have talked about massing at that particular location. It's been discussed at every application. Every conversation been raised as a problem with all sorts of ideas around. This is not a historic barn. This is a new structure, which is totally appropriate as the district evolves. We've seen good new outbuildings. There's one up higher on Hartford Avenue across from the Stillman School building. I don't know the number, it's the museum house. I drove down that way. I hadn't been there in a while and I was amazed. It's beautiful. That project is beautiful. And part of what makes it look so great is that two-car garage with it is appropriately masked to be a half story. It's not a full two stories. It's set way back from the sidewalk and it's catty corner set way back from the house. So regardless of trying to talk about historic locations of historic barns, this is a new structure. And it is a sizable presence from every perspective. From every elevation, probably the cove is the least impacted, but all other elevations is a significant presence. It's a significant change to the property. And I think it does harm to the district. I think there are many other ways they could do this project, but the way that's come in right now, it harms the district. It's not our best effort.
Yeah, I would like to echo what Claire just said, and that is, if this were another property that wasn't at the important intersection of Jordan and Hartford, I would feel differently perhaps, but I have to take into account that important traffic volume that we have. I mean, if you were to do a survey of the traffic that goes at that intersection, this is a very high profile intersection in our district.
It's a gateway.
Yeah.
It's one of our gateways.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Hearing nothing else, all those in favor of the motion to deny, say aye.
Just one, is it deny or deny without prejudice, just for the record?
I apologize, deny without prejudice to waive another application fee. All those in favor for the denial without prejudice, say aye.
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 I opposed?
Nay.
Aye. Nay.
So that's a nay from Doug and Chris? Okay.
Yes.
With that, the motion carries. The application is denied without prejudice. Application 6026-21, application at 181 to 189 Main Street.
I have a motion. To approve with the stipulation that the wood picket fencing stays as is without the lattice.
I'd second that.
I think that we talked about it a bit. What is there looks good and can be, you know, removed for snow removal and that sort of thing, but certainly suits the purpose with minimal impact on the district. I think the removal of the lattice is an improvement. You know, it's just too much of a hodgepodge with the lattice affixed to the top on the ends. I think it's a much cleaner look and will work well for the property owner.
Agreed.
Yeah, I think Andy's point that it was moved back closer to the building than it was during the COVID time. Plenty of passage there. And without the lattice, it looks great.
All those in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, the application is approved with the stipulation that the lattice not be used. Moving on to the approval of minutes from March 23. May I have a motion?
Make a motion to approve as submitted.
I'll second.
Oh, no.
I will.
All right. Mark. I'll have our discussion. I take back my second.
You can take the motion.
I can just have the discussion. That's right. More than enough, which is to thank our reporter, Linda, for memorializing our discussions, and to thank our historic district coordinator, Kim, for all of the efforts she makes for all of us and the townspeople.
Definitely kudos. It's been a busy couple of weeks on some big applications, and I know her 15 hours of allotted work is always exceeded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none. The minutes are approved. Other business. Any additional public comments, Kim, aside from the ones we read into the record? Damien?
No, but Damien, why are you raising your hand?
For the first time, I realized I should mention, folks, I just want to thank you for your support that I was approved by both Mayor Mike Rell and the rest of the council to serve on the Heritage Commission here in Old Wethersfield. So I only wanted to mention it to thank you, and also to say if there's anything you want me to do in my role as liaison between the two, the only thing I can report from that side, having attended my Zoom meeting last week for the first time in 3 years, I should say, because 3 years ago I helped with the 17 panels, the interpretive panels for the walk, as you call the Heritage Walk, because I did one for Broad Street Green, whatever year that was. If there's anything you want brought to attention with the Heritage Commission, let me know. Obviously, Bicycles on Main is doing well. Thank you.
Can't imagine a more appropriate nomination than yours, Damien. So glad it worked out.
Thanks, Doug.
Thank you, Damien.
Thanks.
Any additional report, Kim?
None.
Nothing today. No additional correspondence?
None.
I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second
everywhere.
Happy spring, everybody.
You bet.
Thanks, everyone.
Walk around pools and fences, right? Okay. Bye, y'all.
Take care, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks, everyone. Have a good night.
Have a great day.